Let's talk about a different topic, which is what you are calling, your department is calling, the Disinformation Governance Board. You unveiled that this week. Republicans are calling it Orwellian and comparing it to the Ministry of Truth in the novel 1984. Can you clarify what exactly is this? What exactly will this Disinformation Governance Board do? Will it monitor American citizens?
Dan, I'm very pleased to do so. It's clear. I mean, those criticisms are precisely the opposite of what this small working group within the Department of Homeland Security will do. And I think we probably could have done a better job of communicating what it does and does not do.
So
the fact is that disinformation that creates a threat to the security of the homeland is our responsibility to address. And this department has been addressing it for years, throughout the years of the prior administration and an ongoing basis. Disinformation from Russia,
right.
China,
we know
Iran.
The problems, but it's still not clear to me how this governance board will act. What will it do?
So what it does is it works to ensure that the way in which we address threats, the connectivity between threats and acts of violence are addressed without infringing on free speech, protecting civil rights and civil liberties, the right of privacy. And the board, this working group, internal working group, will draw from best practices and communicate those best practices to the operators, because the board does not have operational authority.
Will American citizens be monitored?
No.
Guarantee that.
Well, so what we do, we in the Department of Homeland Security don't monitor American citizens.
You don't, but will this board change that?
No. The board does not have any operational authority or capability. What it will do is gather together best practices in addressing the threat of disinformation from foreign state adversaries, from the cartels, and disseminate those best practices to the operators that have been executing in addressing this threat for years.
Republicans are criticizing your decision, the administration's decision to choose Nina Jankowicz to lead this disinformation board. They say she is not somebody who is neutral. Your response?
Eminently qualified, a renowned expert in the field of disinformation.
And neutral?
Absolutely so.
Would you be okay if Donald Trump were president, if he created this disinformation board, governance board, or if it is in place and he wins again in 2024, that he's in charge of such a thing?
I believe that this working group that gathers together best practices, makes sure that our work is coordinated, consistent with those best practices, that we're safeguarding the right of free speech, that we're safeguarding civil liberties, I think is an extraordinarily important endeavor.
Before I let you go, I'm sure you have heard that Kevin McCarthy, now the Republican leader who hopes to be speaker if Republicans take over in November, will consider impeaching you. Your response?
I am incredibly proud to work with 250,000 dedicated and talented personnel, and I look forward to continuing to do so.
No concern about that?
I am not. I am focused on mission and supporting our incredible workforce.
Let's start with the numbers. About 7,000 migrants are currently apprehended per day. That's the highest in years. But your department's highest projections say that number could double or maybe even triple, as many as 18,000 per day, and that's without the pandemic restriction in place. Is that number really possible? And are you prepared, if so?
So, Dana, what we do is we prepare and we plan, and we've been doing so for months, understanding that the Title 42 authority that the CDC holds is not going to be around forever, because, quite frankly, we want to conquer the pandemic and put it behind us. And remember, Title 42 is a public health authority. So what we started to do in September of last year was prepare for its end. And we're not projecting 18,000, but what we do in the department is we plan for different scenarios, so we're ready for anything that might materialize.
And I understand you're not projecting it, but it is an estimate that was put out by, as you said, by your department. And I just want to be clear, what you're telling me is that because that is a figure, again, that came from you guys, the department is prepared to handle that very large figure if, in fact, that comes to pass, 18,000 migrants per day?
It is our responsibility to be prepared for different scenarios, and that is what we are doing. And we have incredibly talented and dedicated people. There is no question that if, in fact, we reach that number, that is going to be an extraordinary strain on our system. But we are preparing for it, and that is why the plan we have prepared calls for a number of different actions, not just in the domestic arena, but also with our partners to the south.
I just want to, I'm sure you are well aware that there are some of your fellow Democrats who are very concerned about your plans, and they're concerned that you don't have plans that are really strong enough, especially some Democrats who are on the ballot in swing districts. Congresswoman Abigail Spanberger, Alyssa Slotkin, they said that your plan is too little, too late. Congressman Greg Stanton said you are not prepared, not even close. These are your fellow Democrats.
And I respectfully disagree, because the plan that we published this past Tuesday of last week, was not reflective of the fact that we just prepared this plan, but rather we've been planning for months and months. And we heard concerns, do you have a plan? And so what I did was I published a 20-page memorandum that described our plan in some level of detail to put to rest the concern that we have not been planning. We didn't just start this. We've been doing it for months.
So that's what we do. So if 18,000, if the highest projection, not estimate, projection, comes out, estimate, not projection, comes out that 18,000 people cross the border per day, you are going to be able to handle that and handle it in a humane way.
Dana, that's going to put a strain on our system. Precisely why our plan also calls for a regional approach to what is a regional challenge. Mm-hmm. And we need countries to the south to manage their borders. This is not a phenomenon that the United States experiences alone. There are 1.8 million Venezuelans in Colombia. The Nicaraguans comprise almost 2% of the population in the small country of Costa Rica. We're seeing migration because of challenges that are not, you know, restricted to this area. They are global.
Yes or no, will undocumented immigrants who are apprehended at the border be subject to a COVID test?
So we have been testing.
And that will continue?
And actually, we have moved into a different phase where we will be vaccinating non-citizens who are encountered at the border.
As you well know, there is a big move in Congress to keep what we are talking about, Title 42, in place. And some lawmakers are floating legislation to keep it in place and pair it with what you consider must-pass legislation, some more coronavirus funding for Ukraine. If that large legislation passes, would the president sign it?
I can't speak for the president, but I will tell you that as we are concerned in the Department of Homeland Security, that Title 42 authority, and as the law provides, is a public health authority driven by a public health imperative, and the CDC, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, makes that assessment. What we do is we implement Title 42, as we have been, and when it ends, we will use the other immigration enforcement provisions or the authorities at our discretion.
So you, as the Secretary of Homeland Security, don't have an opinion on whether Title 42 should or should not be in place?
I do not, because I'm not a public health expert. But it's my responsibility to plan and execute as it is in place, and plan, prepare, and execute for the day when it won't be.
You told me on the show last year that your message was, do not come. That was your message to migrants. What's your message now?
The same. The very same. Because our border is not open. What happens now is individuals are either expelled under the Title 42 authority, or they are placed in immigration enforcement proceedings, and they are removed if they do not have a valid claim under our law to remain. And so the border is not open. And importantly, they should not place their lives at risk in the hands of smugglers who exploit their lives for the mere purpose of profit.
So just to be clear, if somebody is watching this from another country considering coming, your message is?
Do not come.